In new Excel version, you have a handful of functions to help you forecast more accurately than before. There are some slight differences in Mac and PC versions, and I will cover them as well. We are going to use sales data here, but really you can use anything that you want. Older versions of forecast still exist for compatibility, but if you are making a new worksheet, you will want to use one of these functions. The first one is forecast.linear. That is the straight line estimate and most similar to the old forecast function. Forecast.ets. It is estimating a trend using seasonality periods. ETS here stands for Exponential Triple Smooth, where Excel will forecast based on trends and seasonality and will give you most weight to the most recent data declining exponentially. Now, what is the length of the season? For that, you will use forecast.ets.seasonality. And it will give you number of periods in the seasonal cycle. And how much are you confident in your results? In this case, you will use forecast.ets.confident. If you are familiar with statistics, this is confidence interval. Also, speaking about statistics, there is also forecast.ets.stat that will give you different statistics if you want them. Windows version has a bit more automatic way of doing forecasting, but both Mac and Windows version work the same. If you want to follow with me, you can download this file for the course resources. This worksheet has 3 tabs. And let me pull this up a little bit so you can see them as well. So here they are. We have forecasting functions. This is this introduction tab. And we have forecast linear and forecast seasonal. So let's start talking about them. Let's check out the first one. In this tab, you have 3 columns. Column 1 has dates. This can be days, months, years, whatever you need. The other one has values. In this case, I used units sold. You can use whatever you use. And the third one is a forecast. Before starting a linear forecast here, let's check out the syntax. So we start typing in, and we see that there is a forecast.linear. So we have 3 arguments. The first one is the date that we want to get forecast for. The second one is the known values of the forecast. And the third one are the known dates for the forecast. Now, there's one more thing you need to do, and that is to use the absolute cell values. You get those by giving the dollar signs in front of these numbers. And there's a shortcut as well. You can select and press F4. And now let's press enter. Of course, we are not forecasting the past, we are forecasting the future. And let's see how this data looks like. Let's Control A, that's to select all, insert, and go to charts. Let's use the simple chart now. So this is our forecast. Now you see this gap here. To get rid of that gap, just need to make this one December value the same as the original one, and they will connect. There you go. This is our linear forecast based on these data, and this is it. Now, what happens if you have seasonal data? Okay, let's go to next step. I set these data to be a bit seasonal, a little bit obviously seasonal. So here also we have a couple of tabs. The first one is date. It's the same as before. Units sold, which is values, same as before. Forecasted values, the third one, the same as before. The three new ones that we see is confidence, upper bound, and lower bound. So let's start checking out forecast. To see forecast values, let's first see the syntax. Start typing in forecast and then select forecast ETS. Here it is. We have several arguments here. We have target date, values, timeline, seasonality, data completion, and aggregation. So target date, we know this one. It's let's do it actually this 30. Then we have values. That's our units sold in the past. We have timeline, which are our dates in the past. Now we have seasonality. You can put any season that you think it is, or you can use calculated seasonality, or you can let Excel do its own default calculation. You have data completion. So what if one of these values is missing? But you have two options there. You have a option of putting a zero as a value, or the second one to have automated completion and to use interpolation between two numbers. And then we have aggregation. This is used when you have two data points for the same date. So which one should Excel use? And you have several options here. The default value is average them out, but you can use maximum, minimum. You see all seven here. I'm gonna use defaults here, and like before, use absolute cell values. Again, select them, press F4 and get dollar signs, and press enter. So again, we're not forecasting the past. And again, I'm gonna put 755 here, which is the same value as December. So what's the seasonality here? You remember we had some seasonality. How are we gonna calculate it? So there's a seasonality function. And let's see the syntax. Forecast.ets.seasonality. So it has values, timeline, data completion, and aggregation. So I think all of these arguments are known to us. So the first one, values, we select them. Timeline, select it. Then data completion and data aggregation. Let's leave it by default and press enter. So our seasonality is 8. And how confident are we about these numbers, right? So there's a function for confidence. So let's see. Forecast.ets.confident. And let's see the syntax. So we have several arguments here. And most of them are known to us by now. So the target date, right? And the values, it's known. And the timeline, it's also known. Now, confidence level, by default, it's 95%. And if you remember from statistics, that's 4 sigma. So the way to put it in, if you want to put it in its numbers, is like this, 0.95. You can put higher or lower. I'm going to leave defaults. Then seasonality, you can use the one that we have or leave it by default because Excel will calculate it. Again, these are known values, data completion and aggregation. So I'm going to leave everything as it is by default. And double click on the lower right part to get all the values. There you go. Oh, I forgot. And use absolute cell values as well. So now you're going to see that there is a slight difference for the future. Oh, so let's see what happens for the last one. For the last one, you see, it's not using any values. It's not using all the values. It's shifting down because it's relative. So that's why we want to use absolute values. And you see that there's a huge considerable difference now. Now we are actually using the same numbers. And where can we use this confidence in? We can use it when calculating upper bound or lower bound. And it's pretty straightforward. For upper bound, you can use, you do it like this, forecasted values minus confidence values. Oh, sorry, plus confidence values, my bad. And there you go. And for lower bound, you get forecasted values minus confidence values. And there you go. So that's it. And we can check statistics as well. Statistics. To see all kinds of statistical data. That's forecast.ets.stat. So again, most of these are known to us. The first one is values. The second argument is timeline. Now third argument is a new one to us. That's statistics type. Default one is alpha parametric of ETS algorithm, but you have 8 more there. So I'm going to leave, let's put second one. Seasonality, let's use this one. Then let's, for data completion, let's use automatic. And for aggregation, let's use average, which is a default anyways. And in the end, you see, the beta distribution is very low. So now we come to the part where we see the differences between Windows version and Mac version. So let's start with doing this in Windows version. you go to Data tab here and select Forecast Sheet. And voila, that's it. It gives you the forecasted value. This is the middle one. Upper bound is this one, and lower bound values. There are options as well possible. You can see where a forecast is ending. You can expand this or shorten it. You have a confidence interval. As I mentioned, it's 95%. Seasonality detect automatically. It's using 8, seasonality 8, which is default by default values, but you can really change it to whatever you want. You can change timeline ranges, value ranges. You can fill those missing points by using zeros or interpolation. You can use those if you had those duplicated values. You can default is average, but everything else is possible as well. You can show data as tabs, but I don't think it's useful, so I would rather use line chart. And that's it. You click create and you get it. For Mac version, unfortunately, Forecast Sheet does not exist. So in Mac version, you need to do it yourself. Select everything and then go to Insert Chart and use the line chart. And that's it. We don't need confidence. Well, we have confidence, but we don't need confidence line. And this is it. So if it didn't have this last value over the forecasted upper bound and lower bound, we would have this break. And you can use it as well with break or not, but I think it's looking nicer with the connected values like this. So that's it. That is forecasting in Excel, and good luck.